This week, we're on the California Delta with guide Bobby Barrack for stripers on topwater plugs, swim baits, and jigs. It's November and prime time for red-hot fall stripe bass action. I'm Justin Wolf, and this is Angler West Television. In 1879, striped bass were first transplanted to California waters from New Jersey. And today, stripers occur as far south as Baja California and as far north as Barkley Sound in British Columbia. Within this range, striped bass have most successfully adapted to the San Francisco Bay Area and especially the Sacramento-San Joaquin Delta.
Oh, it comes off again.
Oh, here we go. Oh, here's Shamu. Here's Shamu right here, buddy. Come on, sweetheart. Come on, sweetheart.
But from now on,
come on, girl.
Will be entirely different. Cause I knew the moment I lost you.
Due to their tasty disposition, potentially large size with many caught over 40 pounds every year, and incredible fighting ability, California anglers continue to pursue stripers with ever greater intensity and interest. And those anglers, I think, who have discovered the topwater bite enjoy their time on the water with these fish the most, because the striper, maybe more than any other fish found in fresh water, can attack so ferociously, yet still provide a true challenge to even the most skilled fishermen in the world.
Due to all my weary and my disappointment,
come on.
There is still a little light shining through, and from now on I will entirely different. And I knew the moment I lost you.
I want to scream.
Today, we're fishing the California Delta with professional angler Bobby Barrack, who's not only among the elite of professional bass fishermen, but also among the most respected guides fishing the Delta for both bass and stripers. Today, Bobby is fishing with Mike Van Wagner.
First thing in the morning, we try and evaluate the activity level of the fish. Sometimes they're pretty hot, and it's right off the bat. And then sometimes you got to check a few little spots here and there. I like to target the shallow areas next to deep. The target zone's 5, 6, 7 feet of water, but we're going to have 30 feet of water in close proximity to that. And they're just feeding stations. So we're going to check a few little feeding stations. We've got a variety of topwater baits. We got a big wake bait, big AC plug wake bait. We got a Black Dog Slammer. I've got a Reaction Innovations topwater bait. And that's our top water repertoire for today. And then we got some subsurface stuff. Hopefully we don't have to do the subsurface until a little bit later. We're gonna give that top water thing a pretty good shot. And we'll hit about 4 or 5 top water spots this morning. We'll see if we can make it happen. But we're gonna move kind of quick. We can't move very fast this morning because we got a little bit of fog, which is fine. But we'll see what we can make happen.
I'm Merle Haggard, and you're watching Angler West Television. Stay tuned. There's a lot of things to come.
Welcome back to Angler West Television. I'm Justin Wolf. It's an early November morning on the California Delta, and we're fishing with guides Bobby Barrack and Mike Van Wagner, who have set up on a likely feeding area for stripers, throwing coordinated topwater lures, hoping to put together the right recipe for success.
See, and we got two different types of topwater baits going. I've got a smaller topwater bait that makes a little bit of noise, and Mike's got a big wood plug. He's throwing Mike's got the punker on, which doesn't make any noise. It's a more subtle bait, but it's a bigger bait. So sometimes these stripers will lead a topwater bait that makes noise, and then sometimes they'll ignore it and they want a more quiet bait on the surface that just moves water. That's what's nice about them big plugs. You can throw them about a mile. You know, we got two baits going. We got two different types of topwater baits going. We got one quiet one that's a little bit larger than the noisy one that I'm using. But we're also gonna adjust our cadence. I'm gonna fish a little bit slower. Mike's kinda pop, pop, pop. He's juicing it a little bit. And then he'll pause and he'll slow it down. So we're gonna play with the cadence. You know, every day is different with these stripers, man. Sometimes they want it just blazing across the surface. And then sometimes they want a nice, steady, easy walk side to side. And then sometimes they want steady, steady, juice, juice, juice. I got that word from Jerry Cochran. He's one of my clients. And you juice it, and then kind of ease it up again. So you gotta play with the cadence, real important. Mike, I thought you said we might get some big bites on our first two stops.
You're the guide, man. You're the one that's got these big guys dialed
hey now,
in.
See, the thing is, we're fishing the spots that Mike suggested, our first two stops here. If we saw a lot of whitewater and a lot of explosions, then they would be my spots. But being that they're very non-productive at the moment, let's just say they're Mike's spots. Here, fishy, fishy. These fish are acting like they ate last night, Mike.
They're not wanting too much to eat this morning, huh?
There's not a lot of activity yet at all, which is fine. Hey, we're gonna deal with it. You can't catch them if they don't want to eat. So we're just gonna wait for... Maybe they're gonna have a little bit of a late breakfast this morning. Yes. That's all good. See how that fog's starting to come in? A lot of times this time of the year, I mean, we had a little bit of fog this morning, then it kind of cleaned up. And then a lot of times as that water starts to move, that fog will move with it. And so now that water's going out, so that fog is being pulled from the valley through this area right here. And it's amazing how all that stuff works together. But I would think that hopefully, if everything works out well, within 15 minutes to a half an hour, this will be blanketed with fog, which is a good thing. Low light level's always good when you're trying to catch big stripers in shallow water. So, but if this fog goes away and we don't get any wind and it goes flat pancake, that could be a brutal situation. So we're hoping for the fog. If we start getting some boils and they don't actually break the surface and eat that bait, we've got some follow-up bait. I got a Berkeley Power Mullet right there. Might have to wing that thing around a little bit. A lot of times if they'll roll on the bait and they won't commit and come through the surface, you can pick up a bait like this right here and throw it through the boil and just slow swim it, and they'll grab that. So if they start swirling on it and not truly committing through the surface to get the bait, that's what we're gonna do. Most of the stuff that we're fishing right here, we're trying to stay in that 3 to 6 foot zone and look for some of them big big shallow cruisers. You know, a lot of these big stripers, when they get up into the Delta system, they start to key in on small largemouth, panfish, bluegill, crappie. We've got some golden shiners that are starting to move up. Well, they've been up for about a week and a half. And so that, you know, that's where the food source is. So these bigger fish will move off the main channel, kind of cruise the shallow flats, get their bellies full, and then they'll back off and they won't eat again all day long. So we're kind of looking for fish that feed once a day. And so far it hasn't worked out real well, but like I say, we're gonna stay with it and we're gonna see if we can create it. Come on, sweetheart. Come on, baby, come on, baby. Take a good look, sniff that thing. I should have put some proc here on that punker, huh? Quit swirling on it and open your jaws. You gonna take that one?
I'm gonna try to pull that one.
Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Mike, this is hot. This fish is hot. Bring it right through there. Come on, eat that thing. Eat that thing, eat that thing. Bring it through that boil, Mike. Did you get it? There you go. That's not the thing, man. That's not the one we're looking for. Mike, catch bigger ones. We got a camera going.
That was that little one that was chasing that big one behind you. Fish was boiling up on Bobby's bait and threw a little follow-up bait in behind it. There was actually a lot bigger fish back in there behind it, but the little one came up and was a little more aggressive.
The old bait and switch, Mike.
Yeah.
You know, that also works good with a fly rod. You know, if you got a guy throwing topwater up front and you got a guy that's fly fishing in the back, a lot of times when you get the interest of those fish and they're tracking the bait and they're under the water and they're looking up and they take a little swipe at it and they come over here and they're still focused on that right there. Well, if the fly guy is on the clock and he can throw at those boils, if he gets that thing within a foot of the boil, and he'll usually get about two strips and he'll be on, you know, it's good stuff. That was a giant. Oh God, look at that. Oh, that fish needed some glasses, man. Swing that guy over here, Mike. I'll take care of him. I think I got some pliers around here someplace. Settle down, settle down. I tell you, with these stripers, they're so dangerous.
They start flopping all over the place and get those hooks.
Yeah, I like to try and pin their heads so they can't shake. Grab a hold of their mouth, then I can work on them a little bit. Not the biggest striper in the world, but good
It'll
job,
work.
Man.
Thanks, bud.
You know, Mike, our fog is just about burned off. And man, we sure didn't get what we were hoping to get out of that low light level situation that we had. I got one swirling on me right here. I don't think it's a big fish, but they're definitely wanting that smaller topwater bait. We'll stay with this a little bit. We still got a little bit of high haze that's keeping that sun from giving us 100% light penetration. So we're gonna stick with this topwater a little bit longer. And then we might have to go throw some jigs or some of those power mullets, get a little bit deeper on some ridges. Hopefully we get a little bit of wind. If we can get a little bit of wind, that 10, 15 mile an hour wind is perfect. That'll really help us out. It'll mess up the surface a little bit and refract a little bit of that light so you don't have 100% of that light penetrating through the surface of the water. If you get a little bit of ripple on that water, it refracts that light, and then fish feel a little safer getting up in them shallow water zones and creeping around looking for something to eat. They didn't eat real good this morning, so I would think that we should be able to get something to happen later on today. Make the water blow up, Mike. You're the only one that can get a bite around here.
Yeah. Gotta try to make something happen. get these guys. Oh, he did right there at the boat too. Water blew up back here, but it didn't do much.
A little sprinkle. We lost our fog on the other side of the river, so we, oh, come on. So we looked off to the east, and there was a fog bank. So what we did was we moved about 8 miles, 12 miles, over into this low light situation that we have over here. And we're gonna, like I said, oh, there you go, Mike. Talk her into it. Talk her into it. She get it?
Nope.
Let's see if I can poach his fish.
Still swimming behind it.
Traditionally, this is one of the best ways to poach your buddy's fish. Throw a Lucky Craft rip bait over there. Snap it a few times, let it sit. That's pretty bad when they won't even eat a rip bait as a follow-up. There's a giant, there's a giant. There's a giant. That's a big guy right there, Mike.
That's the man there.
That's a big dude. Boy, she swallowed that poker, buddy. Woohoo! That was cool. Oh, no! No! Is that what happens when you get a camera on board? Oh my gosh. Oh no. Where she ripped her hook off. Oh, you just want to scream. We ran all the way over here for that bite. Oh, here you go, Mike. Here you go, Mike. No, that's not one of them giants. Oh, that makes me sick. God, did she kill that? Oh, did she kill that thing?
Due to all my weary and my disappointment, there is still a little light shining through. And from now on, I will be entirely different. And I knew the moment I lost you.
He's not that one there.
Not that one that rolled on a little while ago, no.
Let's try and catch the other one.
Okay.
Let's make him a little bigger. Get a follow in there, Mike.
In striper fishing, maybe nothing is quite as exciting and potentially heartbreaking as the topwater strike.
Oh, he
dumped it. Dump it? Another one just grabbed it,
he
I
just
think.
Grabbed it and dropped
but throwing
it.
Swim baits and jigs might be a close second.
There he got it.
The first one that rolled through there looked like a better fish.
I was saving that better one for you to catch on that.
Yeah, I threw that punker over there and she rolled on it. What'd she eat, that pogey?
Ate the little swim bait.
That's another example. When you see, you know, a lot of times when you're floating across these ridges, you'll see fish that'll push bait right to the surface and, you know, you'll get that swirl. And I always throw a topwater bait at them like I did right over there with that punker. But Mike picked up his little pogey, that pearl pogey, and he threw it through the swirl and one of the smaller fish ate it, unfortunately. But you know, if you got kids in the boat or whatever, just let those kids throw that little pearl-colored swim bait. You know, there's a ton of them on the market, and you'll be in good shape. One of the things I really like to do is I like to put a chartreuse line on all my pearl baits. So I'll get one of these little pins, and I'll just draw a chartreuse line right down the side, just like that. A lot of shad, if you look at them in the light, if they turn sideways, you can see a distinct chartreuse line that goes right over the top of their back and just finishes out. Starts right behind the gill plate and goes right out to their tail fin. And that's a great representation of a shad.
Late in the afternoon, Bobby and Mike caught many stripers on pearl-colored swim baits and hair raiser jigs.
There he is. Boy, them jokers are in the dirt, man.
Which is plenty of fun, but there's no doubt that the topwater sensation was the main attraction.
They're not huge, but they're fun. Come on. Come on, come on. Go, they're doing cartwheels, Mike.
If you throw topwater baits, it's probably not so much to catch big numbers of fish, but rather to experience the thrill of finding your fish, making a perfect cast, feeling the incredible sensation of a big fish crashing through the surface, hook up, and then to have the fight of a lifetime. Or not. Thanks for watching today's episode of Angler West TV. You know, it's only with the sponsor support that this show is made possible, so please thank them when you can. Now get out there and do some great fishing.